Hey everybody, this is Pastor B, and it is so good to see you on the ninth day of June 2020. And my, how the world has changed. Not only are we dealing with the coronavirus, but the worldwide outcry over the death of George Floyd. People across the world, not just the country, but across the world, have been flooding the streets and making demands that people have to be treated fairly. This is not a demonization of law enforcement. There are good officers, probably more good ones than ones that are not following the rules. But people across the world have jumped out in protest at the death of George Floyd, people who will never know him, never knew him, and will never know him. In the midst of all this, it's really easy to get caught up in the energy and the excitement and the movement. It's easy to leave our homes and go into the streets to protest and to make demands for fair treatment. But for the believer, it's a little different. For the believer, fairness is not just a good idea. It's not about energy. For the believer, fairness is not about people feeling good even. For the believer, loving others and being fair is a command. It's not a good idea. It's not something that you ought to do. It's not something that people deserve. It's not based on whether they deserve it. It's a command. God says, Jesus says, love God and love neighbor. Those are the greatest commandments, commandments, and the summation of the entire law. And there's a difference between a good idea and a command. For example, once I told my daughter, I said, you know, because you have to read at least 30 minutes every day, if I were you in the summertime, I would get my reading done early in the morning. That way I have the rest of the day to do what I want. She said, well, I'll think about it. And she said that because she knew it wasn't a command. If I had made it a mandate, I'd have said, Layla, from now on, you're going to have to read 30 minutes every day in the morning before you start doing everything else. But she didn't hear that. Instead, she heard what I gave her, an option, an idea. Take it up if you want. I'm trying to give her a little independence. The point is, for God and for the believer, love and fairness are not ideas. They're not good things you ought to have in your community. No, they are mandates. They're things that mandate our obedience as a part of our covenant relationship with God. So even after the energy's gone, even after the marching is gone, and no matter how difficult it is, God calls us to be people of love. So what does love look like? Jesus illustrates for us what love looks like in the Gospel of Luke chapter number 10 in a parable called the Good Samaritan. A guy walks up to Jesus and says, Teacher, what is the greatest commandment of the law? And Jesus says, well, of course, love God and love neighbor. And the guy says, well, who is my neighbor? And Jesus begins to tell a story of a person that we come to call the Good Samaritan. He says, a man is going down the Jericho road and he's attacked by robbers and left there to die. And two religious folks walk by him and ignore him there, busy, not wanting to touch him because he's bloody, who knows. But a Samaritan, somebody who wasn't expected to stop, stops, picks him up, cleans him up, takes him to an inn, gets him a room, and tells the innkeeper to keep him there. And no matter how much it costs to get him back to health, the Samaritan would pay for it. In that parable, we see a couple of distinctions about love. For example, love, number one, is inconvenient sometimes. The Samaritan had somewhere to go. He wouldn't have been on the Jericho road if he wasn't going somewhere, but he stopped. Even though he had an agenda, he stopped to help someone who needed help. That's what love looks like. It interrupts our schedule so that we can help other people when they stand in need. Another thing we notice about love is that love looks beyond historical stuff. Historically, Jews and Samaritans didn't get along, but Jesus says that this Samaritan, because he saw the need for love, stopped. He did not consider all the other stuff in the air and helped this person out who needed to be helped. Love looks beyond the past and helps people to get whole today. It doesn't ignore the past, doesn't act like the past is not present, but it moves beyond the past to deal with the moment of present pain. That's what love looks like. The story of the Good Samaritan also reminds us that love is sacrificial. It costs to love. in the parable, the Samaritan pays for actually dollars and cents so that the person can come to hold us. And sometimes love costs something to us. Finally, a fourth thing, there's several things, but a fourth thing, and we'll conclude here. Love looks beyond present difference, not only past problems, but present difference. Samaritans and Jews were not the same, but when there's pain involved, and when God gives us a mandate to love, we love, no matter what the differences are. Jesus caps it all off with a phrase that we all need to hear after we hear the parable of the Good Samaritan. He says, "Go and do likewise. Go into the world and love. Beyond past differences, beyond present differences, sacrificially, even if it interrupts your schedule, love." I promise, if we all apply the rubric of Jesus' love, the world would be a better place. And maybe we wouldn't be in mourning like we're mourning now for George Floyd and so many others who've lost their life. This is Pastor B, again, June the 9th, coming from St. James Presbyterian Church on the lovely James Island. Go to our church webpage, see what we're doing, www.stjamesji.org. Also catch us on Facebook and Instagram. Be encouraged. You've been touched.